Hi there, I'm Larry Dowdy.
And I'm Janet Rose.
And when you hear the name George Caylor, maybe you think of politics, breakfast, a husband, good husband, a grandfather, bass player, fisherman, lover of motorcycles. Great guest on the radio. But today, we've got him here as an author. His new book is called Surviving Georgie. George Caylor, welcome.
Thank you.
We're excited to have you here today, George, and we want to start out by asking you, what is the book Surviving Georgie about, and when and where does it take place?
The book takes place outside Punxsutawney, Pennsylvania, on the little dairy farm. It was Pennsylvania Dutch country, and we were Pennsylvania Dutch, but we weren't Amish. And the book starts off with a little history of the area. For instance, Belle Hartley, who got her foot cut off in a mower, but made her own tourniquet, put her foot in a bucket, and took her foot and herself to the hospital all by herself.
Wow.
And she was one tough woman. By the way, they couldn't reattach it, but she put it in a jar of formaldehyde and put it on her shelf, and everybody who came to see her, it was a real conversation piece
was,
to see Belle's foot. It was reunited with her when she died 40 years later. But there's a big story about her, about my neighbors. And so it really starts with me at age 5, because those were my first vivid memories of when I was causing trouble on the farm. And Surviving Georgie isn't just about the people who had to survive my ages 5 to 12. I was really a weird kid. The world was my Disney World, really. And my Smithsonian Institute as well, and it was for me to experiment. And the people who inhabited my world, they really didn't understand their new roles in life was to entertain me and for me to find out about what works and what doesn't. And so ages 5 to 12, and then it stops to 12 because when I stopped being a non-teenager, well, things changed. So,
as they always do. Yeah.
But Surviving Georgie is also about me surviving those ages. Mm-hmm. And I survived several times. Daddy rescued me from a rabid dog. He rescued me when I fell through the ice. And there's about 12 incidents in the book where he almost gets killed at my hand. And so he survived me, as did my school teacher.
Not only survived you, but lived to be 100.
Yes. Well, Nietzsche said, what doesn't kill me makes me stronger.
There. That's right.
Daddy almost died several times at my hand, and he lived to be 100. So.
Well, you're now 73 and just getting around to writing a book about, I guess, misadventures of your young life, going back to age 5. How do you so vividly remember things 68 years later? I couldn't tell you what I had for dinner last night.
You actually remember things that happened early in your life better than you do what happened yesterday. I have a good memory for details. In fact, when Joanne, my wife, and I are watching Turner Classic Movies, maybe a movie we haven't seen in 30 or 40 years, the actor will be on the screen, and I'll say the dialogue, and then he'll say it.
Wow.
And then the girl will say the dialogue right after I've said her dialogue, and Joanne will say, stop it, stop it. But I remember great details, what people said, how they looked when they said it, the details around it. And you'll discover this if you write a book about your early childhood. When you dig down, you drill a mine shaft way down into the recesses of your brain, what you discover is it starts going out as well. And the things that you haven't thought of in years, maybe decades, come to life. And you remember the most amazing details. Just the way people looked when they said something to you. Usually they looked frightened when they said something.
Yes, that's the name.
But it's 7, and my dad was good at that too. Even at age 100, he could remember when he was 3, when he
was
4.
Wow.
That's amazing.
That is amazing. Mm. So all of your readers are not going to have had the same experiences, certainly, that
none
you've
of them
had.
Will.
No, and certainly not the adventures that you've had, that's for sure. So how do you think they're going to be able to identify with your young life?
I wrote this book for people 60 to 90, mainly. because it's about the way things used to be. The one-room schools, the Judeo-Christian culture, the safety that we felt if you were out all day and your parents didn't know where you were and they weren't afraid because nothing bad happened. I wanted them to remember the way things were. But I was, about a year ago when I started writing this book, I read a story to my granddaughter, who was six, and she said, "Grandpa George, every little kid is going to want to read this book." And I said, "Why?" And she said, "We can't even imagine tying a bunch of chickens to our wagon to make them pull us." The other things that you did in your story.
Wait. You tied a bunch of chickens to your wagon to pull you.
What was after a couple of failed attempts.
Oh.
I tied the beagle to my wagon, and no matter how I beat him, he couldn't pull my wagon, or wouldn't pull it. He just lay on his side and kind of looked around looking like, why?
Why are you doing this to me?
I thought we'd need something bigger than a beagle, and I was able to rope a heifer.
Ah.
It took me about 100 times, but I finally got the rope around the heifer, and I tied the other end to my wagon. But the heifer just stood there, so I picked up a rock, hit the heifer in the rump. Well, you would think that she would just start walking. No, they don't just start walking, they run. Well, when the slack gave out the rope, the wagon, I was introduced to momentum and
right, that's right.
And what happens. And inertia, I was the inertia until that wagon went out from under me. And then as I was lying on the ground, I saw some legs walking by, chicken legs. And I'd seen a box of 20 mule team racks on my mother's laundry shelf. And
which to this day is some good stuff.
Absolutely.
Yeah, good stuff.
Yeah.
But those 20 mules could pull a very large wagon. And I thought, a dog is too small, a heifer is too big and too dangerous, chickens are too weak, but what about a team of chickens? A very big team.
20 team chickens.
The story turns out very, very badly. I won't get into it. Turns out badly for them and for me.
You know, maybe if you had just gone with reindeer,
it would have been better.
I asked my dad to buy me a goat, but we had a dairy cow farm, and we're pragmatists, and goats were out of the question. He didn't like any of my suggestions. For instance, one day he was butchering a hog, and I said, "Why don't we just let the thing loose, maybe for an hour, and then go hunting it? It'll make it more interesting for the hog, and if we don't get him, he survives. We'll shoot some poor dumb hog that did get shot." He rejected that idea. He rejected all my ideas.
Imagine
as well
that.
As the goat. That's why I had to resort to chickens finally.
Oh, okay.
So in Surviving Georgie, I mean, we laugh about this story, but are there serious moments?
There are. When I was in third grade, I lost my best friend, Timmy. And I was with Timmy right before he died. And he said, "Georgie, I'm not afraid. I can hear the angels. They're singing to me. It's so beautiful."
Third grade.
When I was writing about it in the book, I actually started crying. Almost crying now. But there's a lot of touching moments in the book, as well as the funny stories. And just a lot of human interest in the book. The way the small country churches worked back then. We had a solar eclipse in 1954. I think it was October 19th, 1954. And everything got absolutely dark at about noon. We didn't know there was going to be a solar eclipse, and it was cloudy that day. And at noon, everything just turned like the dead of night. Well, we had this rascal in the community, a big drinker, womanizer, horrible person, never went to church. He ran to the church to get saved because he thought the world was coming to an end. But the moon made its way past the sun.
Oh, okay.
He went back to being as bad
as he was
as
back
he
to his womanizing ways.
He
no
was
problem.
Awful.
That's
anyway,
right.
So a lot of human interest stories in the book about the church, but mainly about Pine Run School, a little one-room school that I went to, and the teacher who was the teacher, the janitor, the principal, the counselor, everything. And probably in today's money, got paid around $20,000 a year. You had to really want to teach.
You really
and
did.
And yet our scores were the highest in the Pennsylvania, we called it the jointure, the Pennsylvania jointure, our achievement test. So I think it's because we heard the same lesson over
so
and over.
So many different times, sure.
If you were in first grade and you were listening to the eighth grade lessons, you heard it as you went through school. It was repetition.
And you really knew it by that point.
So. We read the great classics. We read philosophy. It was a great school system back then.
Well, speaking of reading classics, there was an English professor that has compared Surviving Georgie to Catcher in the Rye. I mean, that's pretty big talk right there. Because of your introspection on your life and the people around you, do you think of yourself as a young Holden Caulfield?
Actually, I do, but without the depression and without the psychoses. Holden Caulfield was not funny.
Yeah.
The things that happened in this book, people just... Yesterday, a friend of mine who read an excerpt from it, he's going to do an accompanying Bible study with it, but he said he read this one story, and he had to just leave it because he was choking, laughing so hard about the Christmas program at the one-room school when Mary decided to throw up. It was awful. It was.
That's never good when that happens.
Oh, it was awful. As I was sitting there watching the mothers picking barf out of their kids' hair and clothes and stuff, I started singing, "We wish you a Merry Christmas." Miss Calhoun told me to give it a rest. I wasn't a very good singer.
What else was there to do?
Well, nobody was in the mood.
Right. That's right. That's right.
So a lot of stories from Pine Run School. The games we used to play that required only imagination and other kids. We had no money. We had no playground equipment. We had the most marvelous games. And all of them were dangerous, but there was no there was no lawsuits back then.
Wait a minute. Now, here's something a little different from today. You all actually went outside?
We had an hour at lunch and 2 15-minute recesses. And we went outside. Even in the dead of winter, we built snow forts and
stuff. Oh, yeah.
And played a game called Fox and the Geese. When you have to be outside in the deep snow to play that one. It was a...
I don't think I've ever played that one, Larry.
Well, Pennsylvania snows.
That's right.
They're pretty good.
Something people just won't believe, but if they look in old yearbooks, they'll find it. We boys carried our guns to school. Mm-hmm. You checked your trap lines on the way to school. You went hunting afterwards. I'm talking thousands of boys and some girls carried their guns to school. Mm-hmm. You put your gun in the cloakroom. Mm-hmm. Decades and decades went by without an incident.
Right.
It was a different time.
It was a different time.
It was.
Yeah.
So in Surviving Georgie, is this mainly a story about your life on the farm?
It's mainly on the farm and in the school. But I have to talk about the what we call local color. And I'd probably be classified as local color, but back then I was just a little kid, so nobody would do it to me. But Shanghai Lil, this lady who had a cart, it was like a shopping cart, and it had trinkets in it, she walked all over the countryside selling stuff. And we always bought stuff from her. There was no welfare back then. It was a shameful thing to be on welfare. So you survived any way you could, and you ate groundhogs or whatever there was to eat.
Right.
By the way, groundhogs are really good eating. You don't want an old, tough, fat one, but you know, young groundhogs.
Other than that,
especially around February 2nd.
That's right.
Sorry, Phil.
They actually don't come on February 2nd. But it's mainly about our family and life on the farm and the dinner table and what happened, sharing time. When I learned how to lie, because what I had to share, I was afraid it would make everyone sick, or even worse, scare the daylights out of them. So, I just lied at sharing time. And the antics of when my older sister burnt the spaghetti, I mean really burn it, and she announced to the family that she had read in the Compton Encyclopedia, which we now had, that the sense of taste was actually smell. And if we all hold our noses, that you wouldn't be able to taste the spaghetti. Carbon was good for you. So all of us, including Daddy, were holding our noses. I wish there had been a video of that.
And did that work?
So funny. Until Daddy realized what he was doing and threw down his fork. This is dehumanizing. Anyway, so a lot of stories around the table.
So you talk about your family a lot. Are there other main characters that kind of pop up periodically throughout the stories?
Yes. Bob Linkenfelder, who was our farmhand and the strongest man I ever knew. He's still alive. He's in his 80s now, wonderful man. But he could pick up a full 55-gallon drum of diesel fuel by the lips and just carry it across the garage.
Oh, my word.
But the main story about him is at the Hawthorne Carnival at the sideshow and the chimpanzee. If you stayed in the ring conscious for 30 seconds, you would win $35. And that chimpanzee had absolutely beaten the daylights out of hundreds of men all across America. Yeah. And then I go into great description of what he did to the two big guys before Bob got into the ring. And they were screaming to get out within 5 seconds. Each of them. He fought dirty, that chimpanzee.
That chimpanzee.
And then Bob got in. I won't tell the end of the story, but it made local legend.
Quite the stir.
By the way, the chimpanzee concession was closed the next night.
$35 was a lot of money back then.
Back then it was like $500.
Sure.
Now.
Yeah. That's
but
right.
He won it, and he dropped the chip, picked up the $35, and walked out of the cage.
Wow. That's
so, George, funny. in this book, Surviving Georgie, who is your target audience?
As I mentioned, I thought it was guys my age to relive the era that they knew and that they must certainly miss. You have kids walking around staring into their phones nowadays. Even when they're with each other, they're all staring into their phones. And how much more fun it was when we were kids, interacting with other kids, interacting with adults, watching over each other. But then I discovered through my granddaughters, and then through my secretary's daughters, granddaughters, that little kids want to read the book. And so what we're going to do, we're going to have a Surviving Georgie accompanied by a coloring book. And the illustrator, Steve Bartholomew, his illustrations are simply fabulous. You're there when you see, I couldn't possibly have a photograph of what went on back then, because there's no photographs of anything I would have done. But he drew the illustrations. He's going to do a coloring book, and there'll be an accompanying Bible study of what did Georgie do that really God would not have approved of, and how did God's grace save the people in Georgie's life or save Georgie himself in this situation. Right. So a lot of questions like that from the Bible where the kids have to find the verses that would apply.
Which is really, I mean, when you think about it, that's really beautiful. I know I try to do that with my children even now when they have a misstep or we enter into a scenario that, you know, there's always an answer in Scripture. So I think that's really exciting.
I think a lot of parents who work with their kids through the Bible study be a little bit like the children's sermon. Mm-hmm. When you hear something, that never occurred to me before. I think parents will be getting a lot out of the coloring books and Bible studies as well. And then they were talking about having a Georgie doll. I was a cute little thing when I was 5 years old. So maybe pattering. I got ugly afterwards, but pattering a doll after me and maybe some other merchandise. We'll see how it all works out. I don't know if I would have done this had I known how complicated it was going to turn out.
Right. But there's still a lot of stories left to tell, I suspect. So if this goes the way we think it's going to go, will there be follow-ups?
I have a friend in Atlanta who writes books on the rock bands of the 60s. Mm-hmm. He's written a couple of successful books. And he's asked me several times if I would write a book on the rock and roll era, touring for 6 years. And I think my next book, though, after this one, whatever it is, it'll be very different, because I was different. Mm-hmm. I turned 13, got into high school and college, and so on. So we'll see how this one goes first. People might hate it.
I don't think so.
Well, we'll see.
I don't think so.
George, anybody who's just walking into the room and hearing this interview now, if there would be one takeaway for you from Surviving Georgie, what would it be?
The love of family, the love of community, and a strange little boy who they loved childhood. A father's love especially. It's almost Christ-like. My dad's love
it
for me.
It should be.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And the way he saved me. By the way, he didn't save me from his own spankings. they say spanking works. I don't know if it does or not. I would be back in the fray.
Well, you're still here. So it
there's
must
one
have...
incident where I almost killed him. And I got yanked out of the truck, and as he was pummeling my body, I was thanking God. Thank you, God, a dead man kept me doing this. That's in the book as well. When I turned, that was about the last story in the book, when I turned 12, and I ran the truck into the tractor, knocked Daddy off the tractor, and I was sitting there. Oh, God, I killed him, please don't let it be. And that's where my body came flying out of the truck. I was thanking God for the
You're like, oh, well, no, he's fine.
He's alive.
Well, I can't wait to read the entire book. We're very excited. Wish you nothing but good things. Surviving Georgie, I think, is going to be quite an adventure for a lot of people. So we're excited to be a part of it.
I appreciate the interview.
Thank you.